Hello, I'm Jane Horrocks, and I'm wearing an outfit by Ali Capolino. And it's a long skirt and under top, which is covering my bump.
Are you on the baby then?
Yes, I am.
I'm wearing a jacket,
yeah,
waistcoat, trousers, and a pair of shoes.
Where do you buy them from?
Racing Green.
Oh, wow.
M&S.
Fantastic.
Churches.
This is from Jigsaw,
yeah,
and I bought it today, and it's moleskin. Right, and I did have a pair of moleskin trousers. This is so dull.
That Sarah bought me for Christmas
that I was going to try and wear with it, but they didn't quite match.
Good evening. How very charming to see you, as always. I want you to mind my cufflinks, which will tell you that it is 12:30, nearly 1:35 in London, and 7:55 in the evening in New York. Genuine working clocks that are also cufflinks.
It was in fact an Englishman, Charles Frederick Worth, who came from Ipswich, that opened the first couture house in Paris to make made-to-measure clothes. In recent years, this rarefied world has fallen under threat as customers have defected to buy ready-made clothes. But in recent years, a new wave of pop and movie star have discovered couture. And the French have returned to the British for help to bring haute couture into the 21st century.
Haute couture is the art of handcrafted clothes, and in ateliers, the workrooms of the designers all over Paris, tailors, seamstresses and embroiderers have been adding the finishing touches to the season's collections. At exclusive locations all over Paris, some of the world's richest women settle down to a fashion show in which every garment has cost about £10,000 to make. Globally, it's estimated there are only 2,000 customers, so the great fashion houses are under pressure to move with the times.
It's the 19th of January, 1997, and as they say in the trade, we're about to witness a fashion moment. At the tender age of 27, British designer of the year, Alexander McQueen, is about to show his first haute couture collection, and also his first clothing designs for the esteemed house of Givenchy.
Dedicated the show to the ateliers. You know, the designer is sort of like put there and is God and all this sort of crap, but at the end of the day, it's okay designing the most amazing outfit on paper, but it's got to be executed. And if you don't know how to cut, sew or make, then the thing's never going to be evolutionized. You know, these people should be cherished because it's a dying trade in some people's eyes, and if you can bring it into the 21st century with clean design, a modern design, this is how it's going to be done. And at the end of the day, they may look modern, but the techniques to make them are still from ancient times. The way fashion is today, it's about individualism, and you can't get more individual than Alexander McQueen at Givenchy Couture.
Grecian nymphs and supermodels in shades of gold and cream, fusing traditional McQueen military splendour with mythological grandiose, lived up to all expectation. This was a collection of supreme confidence crafted by a young East End man who is fast becoming an international legend. And to conquer Paris, he brought with him a string of leading London specialists.
He said he wanted to take London to Paris, and that's exactly what he did in a big way, really. I think British fashion has a lot of craft to offer, and I think he's taken that across the water, as it were.
It's really exciting to see English designers have a huge contribution in what is a French industry. So it's very good for England, it's very good for English-British fashion, and it's very good for British design, and British fashion needs as much encouragement as possible.
In spite of the fact that Alexander joined Givenchy 2 months ago, he brought it all of a sudden into modernity. It's amazing.
I think that the beginning of this cooperation is so fruitful, so enthusiastic, so I strongly believe that it will last for long.
This was a debut collection with a brief, no doubt, to attract much press attention. Some journalists, however, found McQueen's more dramatic approach hard to take.
You can't come to Paris and compete with the Valentinos and the Chanels and the Lacroix and expect to win at 27. It wasn't good enough. It was okay, and it's fine if you showed it in London, but it was too derivative. And the tailoring wasn't quite what it should have been. And I, you know, he's learned a very salutary lesson, and I think it'll make him a much better designer. It's kind of nice to have a little failure early on, rather than go through 3 or 4 great collections and then have a failure, because then you really can't cope with it. So I think it was a brave effort.
At the Grand Hotel, traditional home of the Dior shows, well-heeled clients and press arrive to see if John Galliano, the new young pretender from Great Britain, will create world-shattering fashion news the way Monsieur Dior did 50 years ago. Luring Galliano to their stable could be the shrewdest move luxury brands company Louis Vuitton Moët Hennessy have ever made. They groomed him for the most important job in fashion by introducing him to the world of haute couture at the House of Givenchy. After just 2 seasons there, the announcement last October that he would move to the sister company Dior was received with breathtaking excitement by the media. This show confirmed that he is indeed the greatest designer of our time.
The idea was to redefine the look of Dior. So when you saw a lady walking down the street, she is the new Miss Dior. Redefine the fit, bring in a lightness, less Roman, which it had been to date, and modern, and very feminine, very feminine. My intention was never to just do a rehash of the new look, because I don't think that was kind of relevant or terribly exciting for today. However, I did spend a week in the archives, and I'm glad I did. I mean, to understand the construction, to honored to be able to look at those clothes and turn them inside out. And it was then that I decided that I wanted to almost imagine what Monsieur Dior would do if he were alive today and under the influences of the modern world. You have to remember, I do want women to wear these clothes. Although there's no cost restrictions, I do want them to be accessible. I mean, there's only like 2,000 women who can buy these kind of clothes in the world. And it's competitive at this. It's not dusty anymore, it's like really funky and happening, and you can tell from Paris it's like overloaded. There is an excitement, which is great.
After a hard day at the shows, the magazine world doesn't sleep. At the Astra Photographic Studios in the heart of Paris, American Harper's Bazaar are the first to get their hands on the collections, and they'll shoot through the night to meet their deadlines. Is this a vintage year?
Yes, it is. For us, it's a very, very special time for couture, because everybody's always saying couture is dying, and what's happening, it's suddenly reliving at a very sort of vibrant pace, and the publicity is so extraordinary in the States. I mean, and the States doesn't even know what couture means, actually. I mean, they don't really get it, but they just like the idea that it's really strong publicity, so we're just going with that.
Here at the Ritz Hotel, once the home of Coco Chanel, Karl Lagerfeld is about to present his collection for Chanel. But in the quest for all things British, he's enlisted the help of the aristocratic and quirky Amanda Harlech.
you think the British are beginning to change the face of couture in Paris?
No, the problem is they like fashion better than the French.
But they enjoy it.
They enjoy it. They don't think it's stupid. They don't think it's superficial. They have a gift for it, to talk about it, to like it. They can be more eccentric. It's never vulgar. They have an approach what's a little lost here.
Everybody's shifting forward a gear, so you're probably going to get a whole lot of new women in their early 20s. You know, the Generation Xers are going to come over and spend more money because we've suddenly got a whole new realm of couture. It's not that kind of fuddy-duddy, kind of just, you know, ladies at lunch type stuff. It's got a lot of nice things happening now, so maybe it's taken another kind of curve. There's a big sea change going on.
It's à bientôt from Paris. Next week, Brenda and Tim are back here muscling in on the menswear collection.